Hi all. Well, today we're going to talk about topological manifolds and develop how you do calculus on these manifolds. There are a lot of useful are needed when you're doing, say you're doing thermodynamics, doing physics on some topological manifold. We have integration along curves in the manifold. We can define differential forms, and we can define a functional derivative. So we break this down here. We're going to be talking about how you define curves on topological manifolds by means of parameterized curves. The parameter is a real number on an interval. Once we have that, we can define the path integral of a differential form along the curve and talk about the idea of path independence, why some differential forms, when integrated, do not depend on the path of integration. Some do. There are functionals we can construct from curves, and quite interesting type of calculus comes from the definition of the functional derivative. And this is also known as calculus of variations. So all of that comes out in a fairly straightforward fashion here. Finally, we'll get to the useful topic of Green's theorem for topological manifolds. So one of the things about topological manifolds that's a little bit problematic, there is no metric, no norm points in a topological space, and all you have is coordinate functions of the points. So what can we do with that? Well, let's first of all take a look at what these types of calculus constructions look like, you know, on the page. First of all, here's a curve is a collection of points, and we're going to be talking about continuous curves. So there's sort of a continuum of points in the manifold M, and we have the task of finding what the integral along the curve is, the integral of the curve gamma, and then if we have a differential form dH, you can write this down in two dimensions like this. How do you integrate a differential form restricted to the curve gamma? So this is sometimes called the integral of a one form on the curve gamma. And then finally, the functional derivative. So if you have an integral along the curve gamma, you can calculate its derivative in the direction of a function f. So that's written this way. You have a functional I here, usually an integral of the curve gamma, and the functional derivative in the direction f is just denoted by this operator d sub f. Derivative allows you, you know, all the useful stuff that comes out of calculus of variations. Okay, so, you know, I talked a few months ago, about this idea of doing mathematics on a desert island where you sort of have to reinvent everything from scratch. And when you have a topological manifold, a lot of the tools that we're used to using in vector calculus have to be carefully re-examined because we do not have a metric. What we're going to do here is sort of take this desert island approach and try to carefully as we can, you know, see how you would develop these powerful analytic tools that apply to manifolds that do not have a metric, do not have parallel lines, and all those handy properties we're used to when we're dealing with Euclidean spaces and Riemann spaces. Okay. First topic, curves in a manifold. And these are usually called parameterized curves. So a curve in the manifold M is a set of points in M, and the set is generated by some functions that are mapping the closed interval J. So J is an interval of real numbers between 0 and 1. You can make this interval other endpoints, but 0 and 1 is fine for what we need here. And so in the coordinate space of the manifold, we have the coordinate functions gamma k. So if you want to know the coordinates of a point on gamma, you evaluate gamma k at a value of t, and that gives you a point in the coordinate space of the manifold that lies on the curve gamma. I guess that's pretty obvious, no surprise there. The functions gamma k of t, and they're n of them, we have an n-dimensional manifold, n coordinates for each point. The functions gamma k give the coordinates of points on gamma, and in that way gamma as a function of t is generated on the manifold by the inverse coordinate function f inverse acting on the coordinate functions. And this generates gamma of t as a curve on the manifold. So the values of this gamma over here are points in the manifold in the topological space. Right away, we can define continuous curves. So gamma t, how would you define a continuous curve on this abstract manifold here? Well, it's done by using limits. And the manifold that we're talking about here has good enough topology so we can calculate limits and neighborhoods. So the limit of these coordinate functions as t goes to some point t0 on the interval is going to be element of Rn, coordinate representation to generate a point in the manifold by taking f inverse, and that generates this point, some point A. This point A here is going to be an element of gamma. And when that limit exists, then gamma is automatically a continuous function at the point A. So we have continuity of gamma in the manifold M. So that's our first step. There's a little bit of subtlety to this, but no real serious problems with defining continuity this way. So let's take a look at this thing in a kind of schematic way. So suppose you have a parameterized curve gamma of t on the manifold, some two-dimensional manifold M2. The curve gamma has a starting point and an end point. So when the parameter is equal to 0, then the coordinates of gamma in Rn generate a point xa and a point ya over here. And so if you map those back, you get the point A in the manifold. So if we look at the coordinate functions in R2 here on the interval, we want to require that these are continuous and differentiable functions, of course. The coordinate y versus the parameter t, coordinate x versus the parameter t over here. And so if you looked at this curve in x and y here, the concrete representation is the coordinate representation over here in terms of the coordinate functions gamma 1 and gamma 2. And so this gives you nice, smooth, differentiable curves on the interval. Now here's a note for experts. The interval 0 to 1 is a directed index of the points of gamma. And so in a topological manifold, this gamma t is called a net. You know, sequences of numbers are countable. So net just means a continuum of points. Then you need kind of the extended definition to a continuous sequence of points. And the points in the manifold generated by this index set of the interval is called a net. A little topological lingo there. Okay, so we have some pictures here of how the points in the manifold get generated by the parameterized coordinates gamma 1 and gamma 2. So we have continuous curves in just a few slides here. We have continuous curves on this topological manifold. So now we have the question, can you do calculus on these curves? You know, it sounds like a good bet. You can do derivatives on those coordinate functions, the gamma k, and so you should be able to do derivatives and integrals that make sense in the manifold itself. But there's a tricky point here. So the answer is yes, but there's a tricky point. In topological manifolds, we have to solve the addition problem in order to make these definitions in calculus make sense. So in particular, if you have two arbitrary points, P and Q, in the manifold, the sum is not defined. So you cannot add, you cannot kind of assume I can take P plus Q. We're used to doing that if you're dealing with regular vector algebra and vector calculus. You can always add up elements of a Euclidean space. So this addition is not defined for points in the manifold, but if you're going to construct integrals and derivatives, you have to use sums and differences of points. Define the derivative of the curve gamma with respect to the parameter t. You would want to write down, but wait a second, look, you've got a minus sign in here, and here are a couple of points. So we can't officially add those two points up. So how can both 1 and 2 coexist? Okay, now what about if we have manifolds where you can add points together? You know, some manifolds allow you to add any points and get another point. If A and B are elements of the manifold En, then A plus B equals C is also an element of En, and that's for all points in the manifold. So if we have this type of addition, it's straightforward to define the integration of curves. And you've probably seen this classes. It's used all the time in electromagnetism, line integrals, and so forth. So let's check that out here. So let's do this in E2. Let's say we have a parameterized curve. Notice these curves, the coordinate functions, the gamma k, allow you to construct kind of funny-shaped curves that even self-intersect. So what's drawn here is a Euclidean space E2 and the curve gamma here, this S-shaped curve. And gamma is defined on the interval such that when t is equal to 0, gamma gives you the point A. So here is our point A. And when t is equal to 1, gamma gives you the point B. Here's the endpoint B. And so because we have these vectors in Euclidean space, we can construct delta gamma along the curve by subtracting adjacent points. So in particular, here's how you would define the integral along this curve. Partition of the curve into a bunch of points here. Take the difference between two points by a vector addition and sum them up to k. And then if you refine the partition along the curve so you get more and more of these little intervals, eventually you get the integral along the curve. And you can actually evaluate this for every one of these differences. And so when you integrate this curve along all this funny path, all you do is you get back to the point B. So you started at the point A, you end up at the point B, and that's all that's left of this integral. So the integral can be defined then in this way, and it gives you the difference between the endpoint and the starting point. And so we can sketch this in using the parallelogram rule, and it gives you this vector here, and then to make it an element of E2, you have to parallel transport this thing back over here. So the vector C, if you do this vector subtraction, is going to be this vector pointing off over here, which you might worry about. It bothers me. Here's why. Because you have this curve that's nice continuous set of points sitting up here, and when you do the integral, it's giving you this weird point that's not even on the curve. It's like a, who the hell, it's annoying. I'm going to cut out the swearing that I just did, but it really bothers me that you have this nice geometric picture of the curve, and somehow or another, they're telling you that this integral is this weird point over here that's like not even close to this curve you started with. So if that bothers you, there's an alternate definition. We can take this integral here, and instead of performing the vector subtraction, we can simply take the set BA as the result of this integration. That might be useful if you have points where vector addition is not defined, right? So notice that this, if you consider the result of this integral as the set BA, and of course the vector difference is just a function of the elements of this set, so you do encode more information in this set here, BA, than you get if you go ahead and take the vector difference. Spirit of the desert island. I'm just going to point this out. It bothers me. So we note that if you save both vectors, it also happens to be the boundary of the curve gamma, which has a nice geometric interpretation. Now this is something that comes out in a rather interesting intuitive fashion right out here of this simple discussion of integration of curves in two-dimensional Euclidean space. This may be a handy tool later. Okay. Hope you enjoyed this discussion. Please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.